Well, welcome to Cumberland University. What a great night tonight. My name is Ron Patton, Vice President of Athletics. We have a lot of blessings and honors tonight. And so I wanted to say some thank yous, really, to put on this event. I appreciate Brittany McWilliams, Katie Arnold, and Kyle. Give it up for them. Thank you very much. The Student Athlete Advisory Committee. I would like to have the Cumberland coaches stand up. The current coaches, please stand up. I'd like our student athletes that are here tonight to stand up. Excited for the inductees. Should be a great evening. Appreciate Dr. Eric Landis, our faculty athletic rep. Dr. Landis. And I'd also like to thank John Boyce, our MC. John Boyce and I do the play-by-play or some other things together. He's really talented. He's done a lot of things, and I appreciate you, John. Lord, thank you for today. Thank you for these inductees. Thank you for Cumberland University. We're so blessed. Thank you for this food. You know, I pray for a moment of the hurricane victims, North Carolina, Tennessee, Florida. Bless them. Thank you for this evening. In Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Okay, so the first four tables, you're dismissed to go out to the back, on to the left, and shields to guide you right now.
Are you good?
back up the stage, John Boyce. Ron really is ready for challenge, isn't he? Just the microphone. Glad to be here with you tonight, guys. And invite everybody up on stage. We're going to start with Caroline Hayes, the Director of Alumni Relations. She's just going to tell us a little bit more about the Phoenix Foundation.
Maybe that includes some of you in this room when you came. court or on the field or on the mats, but also in whatever vocation they choose and in their academic pursuits and ergo in life. And I want you to help me in thanking Ron Patton for being an outstanding athlete. I want to share one other thing, and then I also want to recognize, let me first recognize a couple of key people. We're here to recognize a lot of amazingly talented athletes tonight, and we're going to get to hear from them. And even the speakers who are introducing the athletes, they're an amazingly talented group of people. I'm not going to call them out by name, but they're incredible. They've given so much to this university. But there are three other people whom I want to specifically call out. Two of our trustees are here tonight. Our current chairman of the board, Mr. Sam Hatcher, who's with his lovely wife, Teresa. Sam, please stand up. Sam was a college athlete. He played tennis here at Cumberland University, so he knows a little bit about athletics. And his predecessor, our immediate past chair, Mr. W.P. Bone, is also here. W.P., will you please also stand? Quite an athlete himself. He just had a birthday last week, but a few years ago when he turned 75, he climbed to the base camp of Mount Everest, and that is quite an athletic endeavor. One other person I want to introduce who also really deserves our thanks and recognition is former president of Cumberland University, one of my predecessors, who really paved the way. I want you to know, he paved the way for me and all of those who followed him. And then he served in the United States Congress for several terms, and that is Congressman Bob Clement. Bob? And I want to, as a final thought, I want to share a quote with you. You all know, many of you know I love quotes. And the person that I want to quote tonight is not somebody whom I often quote, because truthfully, when I was an undergraduate student at a school down in Alabama that was not the University of Alabama, I was not at all a fan of Bear Bryant. But Coach Bear Bryant had one quote that I loved. And Coach Bryant reportedly said, "It's not the will to win that matters, because everybody has that. It's the will to prepare to win that makes all the difference." And I think you all would have to agree with Coach Bryant on that. The preparation is what makes the difference. And it's not only preparation for competition athletically, but it's preparation for life. And that's what we're all about here at Cumberland University. Thank you for being here with us tonight, and enjoy the evening.
At this time, ladies and gentlemen, we'll invite a member of the Sports Hall of Fame Committee, LaQuisha Sanson, to the stage.
Walters, John Franklin, Woody
on the history of Cumberland University athletics and academics. Tonight, we'd like to start off our celebration by bringing back two 1987 Cumberland Sports Hall of Fame inductees, two student athletes whose achievements, both on and off the playing field, continue to inspire. First, let's recognize John Hunt. His time at Cumberland was nothing short of extraordinary. Over his collegiate career, John was a standout in both basketball and baseball, earning the Lindsay Donald Award for 3 years. He was also named Mr. Cumberland for 3 years in a row from 1984 to 1986, a true testament to his leadership and character. In basketball, John was a two-time MVP and earned all TCAC honors in 1986. Not only was he dominant on the court, he also shined on the diamond, earning Pitcher of the Year as well. He was also a distinguished scholar academically, being named an academic All-American in both basketball and baseball in 1987. He also received the Chamber of Commerce Business Administration Award and the President's Award. John Hunt.
Started out together as freshmen, and we got inducted into the Hall of Fame together as seniors.
These two remarkable individuals, John Hoon and Nicky Hill, are the only two student athletes in Cumberland history to be inducted into the Sports Hall of Fame while still students. Their contributions to Cumberland athletics and their commitment to excellence are one of kind. At this time, ladies and gentlemen, our first inductee of the night is Cumberland women's soccer goalkeeper, Lindsay Kitson. Kitson was a three-time NAIA All-American as a goalkeeper during one of the best runs in women's soccer program history. She posted a 54-11-2 record in goal with 39 career shutouts. She compiled 207 saves in net. Kitson is statistically the best goalkeeper in women's soccer history. She was named an NAIA's second team All-American in 2012, third team All-American in 2013, and the only Cumberland women's soccer player to be named a first team All-American in 2014. She helped Cumberland climb to a number one ranking in 2014. The program made three consecutive trips to Orange Beach in the NAIA National Championships, making it to the quarterfinals and the Sweet 16 twice. Cumberland produced three of the most decorated seasons in program history over the span Kitson was the keeper, posting marks of 19-3-0, 16-4-1, and 17-4-1, with one Mid-South Conference regular season championship in 2013 and one Mid-South Conference tournament title in 2012. Kitson was a three-time Mid-South Conference first team selection. She was named the Mid-South Conference Defensive Player of the Week three times and was a two-time Mid-South Conference Scholar Athlete. After graduating, soccer didn't stop. She went on to play professionally in Europe, where she has played Portugal, Israel, and Italy. Let's take a look at some of her highlights in the professional ring.
And of course, she would come up with a superhuman save. She was consistently a leader on the field, displaying hard work. That's why we're here today. But even more so, an inspiration off the field. I remember sophomore year specifically. She came back from summer break and something was different. Firstly, it looked like she had climbed the Canadian Rockies a few times, or that freshman 15 turned a muscle. But either way, it soon became apparent she had found and embraced her authentic self, inside and out, which I'm sure most of you know is not easily done during your college years. But Lindsay, being who she is, was always one step ahead. That year, I watched how she was able to gather an eclectic group from around the world and focus on their differences rather than their similarities, which made a community here. She soon experienced one of the effects of that. For example, there were many evenings we would get done with a grueling practice after a long day of classes, make that long walk to the dorms covered in ice packs, and instead of collapsing in bed like everyone else, Lindsay would quickly get changed and head off to tutor someone for the math class. Some nights, she wouldn't get back until almost midnight or even later. But Lindsay cares more about helping others than herself most times. Speaking of, one of my most interesting memories with Lindsay is a night I thought she had gone out with some friends, but instead came barging through my dorm room door to get me to help her take care of a mutual friend who had a little too much fun that night, which ended up being a tall task, to say the least. But all jokes aside, that again was a glimpse of who Lindsay is at heart. She helps others even when it's not convenient for her. Over the years, that attribute has not wavered. Her love for humanity continues to run deep. And if you personally know Lindsay, you know how blessed you are to not only have her in your life, but also know how deserving she is of this award, due to not only her undeniable talent, but also being a well-rounded, influential human. So with that, I am pleased and honored to bring her to the stage for this award. Please welcome Lindsay Kinson.
Thank you, Beth, for that incredible speech. I do think it's crazy that you just tried to make me cry before I had to public speak, and we'll talk about that later. A little bit about Beth. Beth and I became instant friends when we met at Cumberland, mostly due to being one of few very same people on our team. But we continue to have a lifelong friend, and I have a lifelong best friend, and I have Cumberland University to think about that, and I think many of us here could say the same thing. I want to first start by thanking the community for giving me this honor tonight of being inducted into the Cumberland Sports Hall of Fame. I also want to thank everyone who is here with me, a lot of people who have traveled here from Canada. My amazing friends, Alice, Brittany, Joanna, Christina, Craig, and Tanner. My family, my mom Sue, my aunt Sharon. And most importantly, my incredible partner Amy for being alongside me here tonight. My time here at Cumberland University was some of the best years of my life. It included everything from meeting lifelong friends, learning valuable lessons, and having great professors, and having a family as a team. As Coach Gavin said to me, unfortunately, couldn't be here tonight, it's about time that someone from a team with multiple All-Americans, multiple Mid-South Players of the Year, a conference tournament title, a regular season title, three straight national tournament appearances, including a Final Eight, and a number one national ranking, got inducted into the Hall of Fame. And I'm honored to be the first of many that I'm sure. As you can tell from that quote, I had some of the best players in the country playing in front of me, and I wouldn't be here today without every single one of them. So shout out to women, Cumberland Women's Soccer, past and present. Thank you guys for being here. I truly look at that team like a family. I specifically want to thank Coach Gavin McKenney for taking a chance on me from an awful highlight tape and bringing me down here to Cumberland. He is truly one, if not the best coaches I have ever played for. And what he did for Cumberland Women's Soccer Program in a few short, amazing years is, again, nothing short of amazing. I'd be lying to you if freshman year Lindsay would have ever thought that I would be standing on the stage here tonight, receiving this honor. I owe a lot of my career, to my time here at Cumberland and how it shaped who I am as a player. I went from not starting a single game in my freshman year to becoming a three-time All-American. And a big reason for that is Coach Eric Sussman. Coach Seuss was my goalkeeper coach going into sophomore year and was unable to unlock something with my playing ability to project me to the next level. He was an incredible coach and even better person. We always like to joke that Coach Gavin, Adam, and Seuss were like the three musketeers. They were best friends and balanced each other out incredibly well. Coach Seuss was definitely the lighthearted and humorous one of the three and got along with everyone on this team. Unfortunately, his tragic passing during our sophomore and junior year only allowed us to have a small amount of time with him, but it also brought us so closely together, and I truly believe we all pushed ourselves to be as successful as we were. And so I want to give a special shout out to him, and thank you for everyone being here tonight. It's been an honor to be inducted alongside every one of these amazing athletes that will be also honored here tonight. Thank you.
Our next inductee is former Cullen University pitcher, Aaron Wilkerson. Wilkerson is one of only two former Cullen players to earn either first or second team All-American honors twice during their career. The Waco, Texas native boasted a 12-0 record with a 1.49 ERA and 90-plus innings of work in 2011, earning first team All-American accolades. The right-hander struck out 90 batters in 14 appearances with 13 starts with 7 complete games and 3 shutouts. Opponents batted just 179 against him for the entire season. He ranked 3rd nationally in victory, 7th in opponent batting average, and hits allowed for 9 innings at 5.5 and 9th in ERA. Wilkerson set a pair of NAIA records in 2011 as well, tossing 54 consecutive scoreless innings from February 19th to April 8th. He also won 26 consecutive decisions to end his career. I'm gonna say that one again. 26 consecutive decisions to end his career. He lost his first start of the year, I should have mentioned, when he was a junior before reeling off 14 consecutive victories with 2 in the NAIA World Series, including the championship game, earning second team All-American honors. Wilkerson allowed 1 run on 4 hits with 13 strikeouts in the World Series opener against Aaron Riddle and tossed a 4-hit shutout in the final against Lee University before running into trouble in the ninth. The right-hander then started a game-ending double play that secured Cumberland's second national title and gave up 3 runs on 7 hits with 7 strikeouts altogether versus Lee. Wilkerson was 14-1 with a 2.13 ERA, 125 strikeouts, and over 101 innings of work, leading the nation in strikeouts and ranking 8th in ERA in 2010. Wilkerson was also named the Transcal Pitcher of the Week 4 times in his career. Since Cumberland, Wilkerson has gone on to play professionally in the MLB and the KBO. He made his Major League debut on September 20th, 2017 for the Milwaukee Brewers in the heat of the pennant race. He was named the MILB AAA Player of the Month in September of 21, pitching for the Oklahoma City Dodgers, and is still actively playing in Korea. Now here are some highlights from the 2010 NAIA National Championship game, as well as some from his professional career.
Strikes out a lot of batters coming into this tournament. 105 Ks through 84 and 2/3 innings.
The 0-2 fastball swung on a miss. Do we have played?
There's strike 3 called. He's on his first
offering on the way. Strike 3 called. Pitch swung on. Lifted towards left field. Giving chase. Troy Frazier. He comes down with it. Wilkerson, off speed pitch. Dandy curveball and it's Brown down on strikes.
Pearson of Fanshaw, the 2-2 one-out pitch. Ground ball back to Wilt, goes to second, gets the first there, across the diamond. Second base, Four-three Dogs win, Big Dogs right behind the mound. Do you believe it past the goal?
2-2 the count. Wilkerson deals and a strikeout to end the game. 3 up, 3 down, 2 punch-outs. In Wilkerson's Major League debut, he gets a game finished tonight And the Brewers, on the strength of an eight-run eighth inning.
Opcho, 들어갑니다. 삼진.
속부터하게 타격을 할 필요가 있습니다.
스윙 삼진.
흘려 보냈어요.
투앤투. 바깥쪽 들어갑니다. 삼진.
좌측 골반은 지나가지 않아요. 예. 배트헤드가 지나가지 않아요.
변화구의 생성진 투아웃. 자, 결국은 변화구의 완전히 타이밍을 뺏긴 이재원 선수였습니다.
흘려 보냈어요.
투앤투 바깥쪽 들어갑니다. 삼진.
Some brother James, who traveled all the way from Waco, Texas, so we'd like to write James to accept his award.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for being here tonight. You know, it's an honor for me to be here to accept this award on behalf of my brother. A lot of people don't know that my brother, when he was 16, lost his mother, and it was kind of hard for him, you know, but he overcame a lot to be able to get where he is today, and it says a lot about his character and his resilience. So, the Cumberland family, the Wilkerson family, is forever grateful to you all. Woody Hunt, we talk all the time. Greatest guy, you know, when I dropped my brother off here in 2009. Talked to Coach Hunt, I knew he was in good hands. So thank y'all very much. It's an honor for my brother to be honored this way. And I love you, bro. I know you're watching this. So congratulations. Mom and Dad are very proud.
And I do believe we've got a video from Aaron at this time.
Hello, everyone. This is Aaron. I'm Jewish, and I'm good. I just got home from my team in Korea. But it's such an honor to hold a spot in 2024 for my mom. My time with them was nothing short of amazing. From the athletes I accomplished to the people I've met along the way. Cumberland is what shaped me into the ball player I am today. Winning a national championship was a dream of a lifetime that helped my career into a direction that has been truly remarkable. I want to thank the coaches, Coach Hunt, Coach Knight, and Coach Ryan, for always believing in me, their guidance and their support, for pushing me and molding me into the person I am today. I want to thank my teammates, who became more like family, for always being there for me on and off the field, because without you guys, I wouldn't be able to accomplish half of the accomplishments that I have in my career. it's not here to be, to kind of value something bigger than myself. You know, I'm here to the next and chase the rainbows because I was proud of the way. Thanks.
Our next inductee is two-time NAIA All-American wrestler, Zeke Hunt. Hunt finished eighth place as a junior in the national championships in 2013 and sixth in 2014. He posted a 25-9 mark with wins over six ranked opponents as a senior and was 37-13 with eight victories against ranked foes as a junior. Hunt ended his career at Carmelo with 97 victories as a two-time first-team All-Mid-South Conference selection. He won the NAIA East Region Qualifier in both 2013 and 2014. Hunt earned the prestigious Lindsey Donald Award in 2013-14, presented annually to a Phoenix student-athlete who excels in both academics and athletics. He graduated with a 3.7 GPA with his bachelor's in mathematics. Hunt also went on to earn a Master's of Arts in Education from Cumberland. He is a two-time NAIA Daktronics Scholar-Athlete and a three-time Mid-South Conference Scholar-Athlete, as well as the team's Champions of Character nominee as a sophomore and a junior. Let's take a look at some of Zeke's highlights here at Cumberland.
The right way to say it, so I don't know. I never know the right way to say it. Will they ever have me in? I mean, I'm going to be up in the air every single day. I love it. I love it. I always wanted to go against them. I always want an opportunity to show myself against them. And one day, I got one takedown in Corey. One day, takedown in Corey. That made my day. The rest of the day stuff isn't even. Hello. But it was worth it. It was definitely worth it. But it shows me how to celebrate those small victories in life. You know, too often in life, we're always looking for those big victories, those huge accomplishments, but day by day, we all have those small victories. I think the most important thing I took away from it is it's so important on who we surround ourselves with. Cumberland University is a great group of people, students, faculty, staff, and, you know, you are the combination of the five closest people around you. And Cumberland does a great job of surrounding you with other great people. So, with that, I have some people I need to thank. First and foremost, I want to thank God for, you know, keeping me healthy, letting me wrestle. Like, wrestling is such a privilege. Doing any sport is just such a privilege. So many times you hear about people's seasons cutting short. And I was very blessed that I never had any of those injuries. Next, I want to thank my parents. Just always supporting me emotionally, physically, and spiritually. Just drawing me, supporting me from behind the stands all the time. Faculty and staff, you guys are awesome. You're always there. I'm thinking about it. I never felt like I needed you guys because it was all, you were always there already. Because Walter's always there. What are you grateful for? He never said that to me. He was always saying, why are you grateful for that? But then teammates. You know, people think that wrestling is an individual sport. Because when you stand up from the sideline, you see one guy on the mat. One guy getting his hand raised. But it's not that case. There is a tribe behind that guy, constantly pushing him. And most of the time, that's his teammates and coaches. I would say all the time, that's his teammates and coaches. I know that's for most sports. But I'm going to argue that wrestling is the best. That's my sport. Why would I not? But I have those teammates around me. I can't go through and list all my teammates. There's way too many who, every single day, you get to wrestle somebody else. You get to learn from somebody different. You get to learn that. But there are three teammates who just, I was like, I can't go the night without mentioning these three guys. Because I just, when I think about wrestling here, at Cumberland University, those three monkey guys just kept reeling back in my head. The first guy would be my brother, Noah. Noah was the one who dragged me here. He's hard-headed and hard-nosed, if you've ever met him. He's a little bit feisty, a little bit short. He's got little man syndrome. Sometimes he got in trouble. But he showed me how to fight. And he's the one that, you know, always make me tap out, make me tough. The next one would be Jake Shirley. You need somebody in your life who's there to call you out, to push you. Always to drag you a little bit further than you want to go. And he's always like that. Alright, the last guy is Joey Leach. Joey's over there. You know, Joey just always takes my mind as consistent. Joey's the guy who's always there, and you can always go, hey, I need something. And if you can't get it, he's going to find a way to get it for you. Find someone who can. So, what I really want to say is, this honor doesn't really belong to me. It belongs to everybody who's been behind me, and everybody that's supported me throughout the years. And thank you, Cumberland family. Thank you, guys.
Springer. Springer came to Cumberland after playing for North Alabama and winning a national championship with the football team. He produced a few of the best seasons a defensive lineman has ever had, becoming the only D lineman ever to win the Mid-South Conference Player of the Year award. He was also named a first-team NAIA All-American in 1997. His senior season, he had 78 solo tackles, 64 assisted, and was named Conference Player of the Week 5 out of 9 weeks. His senior season, he had Springer finished his Cumberland career, leading the team to 17-12 record over 3 years, with 34.5 sacks and 28 career starts as a defensive lineman. Springer later signed and played with the Nashville Cats of Arena Football in 1998, and also played professionally in Canada. Once he retired from playing, Springer coached at Cumberland from 99 to 01 as defensive line coach. Let's take a look at some of Heath's highlights here at Cumberland.
He told me last night, 5 minute max. So I told my wife I would not be long. That golly man, how life been brought some memories back. Cumberland Bulldogs, by the way. golly man, seeing Coach Walters, seeing Coach Hunt, seeing KD, seeing Burkey, seeing a bunch of guys I played with, and being able to introduce Heath is very humbling. I grew up a block from here. Me, Scott Hunt, Ryan Hunt, we all said we probably never go to school here, but we ended up here. From 94 to 99 was some of the best times of my life here. I'm indebted to Cumberland. My kids have received degrees from here. I'm a Cumberland guy. So, spring of 95, we get ready to go spring practice, and we got this transfer that came in, and you just got to know he had his UNA rings on, and he was showing his national championship rings off. Everybody wanted to see those rings. But we knew we had a player that was going to help this football team get over the hump. We played on some dominant teams. We were ranked in top 25 in the country a bunch of times. We missed the playoffs. We had an 8-2 team. We missed the playoffs. We sat right down in the locker room and was waiting on the selection committee. And I want to say we might have missed it by 1-2 votes. We didn't get in. I believe if we got in, we would have made it run. Because we were really good that year. But I'm going to tell you a little bit about 70-something tackles for a D-lineman, that's really impressive. Defensive player of the year, player of the week, 5 out of 9 times. Guys, you don't hear that from a D-lineman. Even today, 2024, you don't hear those type of numbers for D-lineman. We played with some of the best teams. He was a brotherhood. We was tight. You know, this day and age, you got teams that are divided. We wasn't divided. Coach Orson Moore had us like soldiers, and it was a brotherhood. Heath is he's a family man. Yeah, he's different now, man. I told him I'd keep a PG-13, and I promise I will. He's a family man. Loves his wife, Robbie. Loves JoJo, loves Hoss. He's a whole lot calmer now. And getting married and having kids will calm you down. Trust me, I know. He wore that number 64 with pride. Something about that number 64. He loved that number 64. He might can tell y'all why he wore the number 64. He told me, but I can't remember, but he wore that number 64 with pride. And he's one of the most dominant football players that ever played. Here. And I'll stand on that and I'll say that and I mean that. It was nothing like Lindsey Collins Pioneer Stadium when they pulled the couches out in the end zone and you had it roped off. See, y'all new guys know about that. Y'all got that luxury. We played right down in the soccer field and it was, you had fraternities right on you when you scored a touchdown. So, I mean, it was a great environment. It was a really great environment. You had the sororities and the fraternities and, you just had the crowd right there with you, so it was a great atmosphere. If I'm ever in a foxhole, I'm calling that guy. It's probably two guys I'm calling first, and it's probably them two guys sitting right there at that table, Thomas Douglas, and Heath Springer. He's a loyal friend, I can call him and say, Heath XYZ, and he said, I'm there. And that's what you want when you get older, you want them loyal friends. And Heath Springer is a loyal guy. I had to give him memory, and I promise I was not, I kept it PG-13, I'm going to keep PG-13. Here's the memory that I have. Actually, let me bring it back up. He sent me a text on the way here, and this wasn't done but God right here. He sent me a text, and he said, I sure wish my pop to see me getting dunked today. But what he didn't know was, my favorite memory was him coming to the sideline after he just punched Georgetown in the mouth pretty good. And he comes to the sideline and he said, Papa, save me a piece of that pizza. And I said, man, it boy bounced his own drama, man. And but what's crazy is Papa saved me a piece of that pizza, man. He ate, and after the game, he's eating that spice of pizza. But if you know he thought a lot of this Papa. His grandma, and I'm not gonna talk all day, but he's Papa smiling now, man. He's happy. He's very happy. Ladies and gentlemen, I present to you the most dominant defensive lineman ever played at Cumberland University to this day, Heath Springer.
Believe me, he lit into me. My baby hair left in my head. Coach Moore was great. I can't start without thanking God for letting me be here. Chavez is right. I ain't the dude I was. I said I knew the Lord then, but I didn't. You can tell if someone knows God or what they say or what they do. And what I said and what I did showed you that I didn't know the Lord. I wasn't terrible. I always use this analogy. Some of the older people would know that I was kind of like Ogre from Revenge of the Nerds, but I was nice and I actually had a brain. You know, but I was kind of that dude. Party, and I'm not proud of that, but I am proud that I follow the Lord now. And I'm not better than anybody that don't know the Lord. But I'm better off than I've ever been in my life because I follow the Lord and I try to do it every day. But and speaking of that, the greatest blessing God has given me is Jesus, because I can know him and be able to follow him and be able to have that promise of eternal life. But right after we're with my wife Robin, she's been something great. Being in this Hall of Fame and being an All-American and being Player of the Year and all that stuff is not the greatest thing coming that gave me. And by far be my wife. I love her. She's been awesome to me, and it's the greatest thing that, besides Jesus in my life, and definitely the best thing to come from Cumberland from here. So she's been great to me, and thank you for that. But I want to thank my mama. If you could have heard the film, if they had the sound, you would have heard her. When I was in high school, I begged the coach when I finally got, well, I was pretty decent. I was like, will you please turn the film down? Because all the kids made fun of me. But she was my biggest fan. And you can even hear it in college. When I was going through getting films for college, you just hear, come on. I mean, boy, she always hollered for me. She's my biggest fan. And I really appreciate that, Mom. No matter what, she was there today, Mom, for me. My dad's always been there for me, and he's still there to this day. He's been great for me. My mama, she has too. She's always loved me. And even when I was messed up, she's still been there for me. And not just my Papa Marks that would always come up here. My Papa Springer, he passed away before I come up here, but he sure would be smiling, no doubt. He was great to me as well. But my Papa Marks, man, and if you had played with me or played for me, I've been coached 27 years. If you played on one of the 29 football teams I played on, you heard my papa. I heard some papa stories. And if he helped me so much and was there for me when nobody else was. And I would not be standing here, and I wouldn't be the man I am. And I'd like to say I ain't nothing special, but I sure try every day. Well, thank Coach Mathis. I probably wouldn't be standing here without him. He's doing a heck of a job with the program. We got to know each other over the years, and I spoke to the team a few times, and Coach was like, man, why ain't that the whole thing, you know? And it ended up happening. Thank you, Coach. Why won't be here without you? Thank you very much. And my friend Nick Perez, I say the same to you, man. Thank you, brother. You're a good man. I thank Nick likes me because when I met him, I didn't know who he was. Because I'm sure he gets sworn a lot. And, we've really become friends, and I appreciate you, brother. Congressman Bob Lim, I thank you for your friendship, your leadership you've had at this school. We wouldn't be reaching the heights we are today if you hadn't put the school on your back. I really appreciate you. I appreciate you being a friend with me, and thank you, sir. Thank you for all you've done for coming. Coach Moore, like Coach Walter said, Coach, and think you called him right now, Coach. I was in there, so I feel like my body's great. I can admit it, but Coach was on me, and he helped me. I still use things to say that I use. He thinks I do his best when I say that, but I use Coach and stuff, techniques that I learned from him to this day, and I appreciate you, Coach. But we were talking about Coach Moore earlier, and he wasn't hard. He's something else. I'll never forget when I met him. He had the ugliest plaid pants. I'm going to go out like all around. He had the ugliest plaid pants I've ever seen in my life. He stood in there and boys in the cafeteria. Had a shirt down my ass, and he said, hey, you're Springer, hey, and he shook my hand, because he's one of my friends. He goes, what do you think? And I'm like, man, I knew that he was a card right then. Yeah. And we would eat often in the cafeteria. I wouldn't be anything Coach Moore. I coached with Coach Moore as a graduate assistant, and when the next year, they didn't have that GA and where I had finished my got my degree here, Coach Moore got me a job as a full-time assistant. Well, they didn't have a a full-time assistant to the position. So Coach Moore took part of his salary and made me a job. He believed in me that much. When he went to the Hall of Fame 13 years ago, I remember sitting at his table, I was so proud of and for him. He could be rough as a cop, man. But he had a heart of gold. And he did so much for me. He literally made me a job. He made me into a coach. I just really cannot say enough about him. Coach Walter Wells, he's the head coach at Eastern Kentucky. He was the guy that recruited me. He come to Loretta and signed me. I want to be here this day. They had a kid that had transferred from Cumberland to UNA, and Coach Wells was talking to a coach down there at the UNA, and he just said, "Hey, man, you ain't got any good linemen that are ineligible." He goes, "I actually, I got one." And I almost went back there, but I needed 3 more years. I knew to graduate. I knew I wanted a degree. I didn't want to pass up a chance. And this door opened, and Coach Wells opened it for me, so I really thank him. My high school coach, Butch Turner, he couldn't be here today. He's got a heart condition, going to have surgery Monday. He wanted to come with something fierce. He's done a lot for me. He showed me how to be a man and to suck it up and be tough. And sometimes you ain't going to feel like lying down. Just like right now, sometimes you don't feel like going to work. But when you're a daddy and a father and a leader, you get up and do it. As part of it, you do what you have to do for your team to succeed. I learned that from Coach Butch Turner, and he's helped me so much in life. Coach Grant Ernest as well. I can be kind of cut up myself. I remember we were breaking it down one day, and my cousin was in the middle. He got that breakdown that day, and I liked to mess with him. So I come running up behind him, kind of giving him the knees, knocked him over. Boy, I was thought I was something. And all of a sudden, Coach Ernest went up behind me and gave me a 13 intimate. And man, he made me realize I wouldn't know. So my first thing hit the ground was my face mask on. Oh, I got up and just walked off in the locker room. I was done. I was in there, took my shoulder pads off, coach come in there, and we doing it. So I'm going home. Ain't nobody doing it. I'm not, you know. He said, "No, you're gonna put your pads on and go back outside. You did wrong, I corrected you, we're gonna go on." And I was like, "No, sir, I'm not." And I remember standing there and I had my hands like this. He took my shoulder pads and slammed them down. I walked outside, but left my arms in my sleeves. With him pushing me out the door, and I wouldn't finish playing ball, I wouldn't be the man or am without him. I wouldn't be the player I became. And I really appreciate you, Coach Ernest. My teammates. Man, y'all are here. Man, I ain't seen you since my bachelor party, right?
Yeah.
I've been married 21 years, officially. So, been a minute. KD, man, he's the heck of a linebacker I played with. Of course, Chavez, he's been on my friend and been there for me. And that's been a pleasure for me to be there for him. And not just have to play with Charles, we coached together. Chris Charles, thank you for coming, brother. We coached together here, but I was in his wedding. You know, you form a bond with, you play together, you coach together, you become family, like some of the people said here earlier. When you work and sweat and bleed and cry and laugh, you just become one. And it's almost tied to blood. Well, thank Big Nathan Johnson here. He's one of the trainers here. He really helped keep me up, man. And he's been a great friend of mine over the years, and has really helped me. He's a heck of a trainer this day. Coach, I'm glad he's working me all out. At least I know y'all got a good one, man. Because you helped me a bunch today. Thank you for being my friend. Thank you for taking care of me. Mike, appreciate you, brother. Thank you. We didn't play late, but you've always been there and been my friend. Love you, man. And thank you so much. Matt, so glad I got to play with you. I hate to go against me a lot, but we still got to be good friends, man. I appreciate you coming. I ain't gonna need talking. Cumberland gave me so much, a degree, a family, literally a family. I wouldn't trade them for nothing. My kids are something special. I love my boy, my girl. I got a girl up in heaven. I know I get to see her one day. And man, if you don't know the Lord, I know this ain't, y'all might get mad at me, but he's down for the family. I'll leave when you got to. But if you don't know the Lord, I promise you, it's the best night I ever did. It's coming. He changed my life. He did the same for you. And speaking of which, Eric, thank you for coming. He changed your life too, didn't he, brother? Praise God. Love you, man. Hey, thank y'all very much. I love Cumberland. And I want to go out with Alan Fingers. Thank y'all.
Grad assistant. So things Charles put in place still goes on today. and he helped build a program from ground up. You know, I'd like to thank Charles. I appreciate everything he's done for me and company. You know, I love you like a son. I'll do anything for you. Me and Charles talk at least once a week. You know, so like I say, he's a modern athlete. With no further ado, Charles and Co-op.
Thank you, Coach Scales. I'd like to thank God for this wonderful day. Thank you to the Hall of Fame Committee for deciding to induct me. It's something big for me. I will cherish this moment for the rest of my life. To my fellow inductees, congratulations. There's no possible way for me to thank everyone that played a role for me being here, but I'd just like to recognize a few individuals. My parents. I come from a town called Kabwe in Zambia, and when I was growing up in our community, it was impossible to be a student and an athlete. Athletes were only people who never went to school, and unfortunately, it's still like that back home. But I thank my parents because out of all my friends and the whole group that I grew up with, they gave me the freedom to pursue academic excellence and sports at the same time. So without them, I wouldn't be standing here today. Coach Scales, thank you for being a coach, a friend. Thank you for being there every step of the way. Thank you for helping me transition from the collegiate running to the professional world. Coach Jenkins is not here today, but this is the guy that gave me a chance. He is the one who gave me my first scholarship to come from all the way from Zambia to the United States. I would also like to recognize a friend of mine. His name is Pamela Nebet. Coach Scales said I was a bridge to the track and field program. But to be honest, Pamela was the actual, he was a bridge. Nene was the first athlete that came to this school. He's the one that opened the doors. Because when Nene came here, I'm sure by now, I was the first national championship, but right now I think there is about 6 to 8. And most of those, we all came after Nene. I'd also like to recognize my family and friends who are here today. Auntie Penny and our pastor, Elkhart. Thank you for everything that you guys do for me. Even though I just come to you guys when I'm in crisis. I'd like to tell you all a short story on how I came to Cumberland University. I was looking out, I had gone to Western Kentucky, so I was looking to come to the NAIA and finish up my master's. So I had a friend at the University of Houston, his name was Dre. So Dre told me, email the coach at the University of Cumberland. For those of you that don't know, those are two separate schools, they're right upstairs. All I had was Cumberland. So I got my phone, emailed the coach at Cumberland, and I got here. After a few months, Dre checked up on me. He was like, Charles, how's it going? I'm like, it's going good. I'm in Tennessee. He's like, Tennessee? It's supposed to be in Kentucky. So I was like, no, it's going great, I'm game. And then he told me I had made a mistake. But well, if that was a mistake, that's one of the best mistakes I've ever made in my life. I got here, I got to this school, everybody was friendly, everything was good. It's just like yesterday when I was here, Coach Barnes is here, Coach Waters. I even got to be close with the president of the school, which is very, very rare for most institutions. And I'm really proud to be a Phoenix. And if I had to choose to redo college, I would still choose to be a Phoenix. Thank you very much.
Our next inductee will be former wrestling coach, Dr. Danny Ryan. Dr. Danny Ryan began the Cumberland Wrestling Program from the ground up and was the team's coach for five seasons from 97 to 2001. The program that was started with Dr. Ryan has blossomed into a perennial powerhouse with four individual NAIA national championships and 41 NAIA All-Americans. Dr. Ryan had athletes qualify for nationals in four out of his five seasons as coach, and notably earned the program's first NAIA All-American honor. Throughout and after his coaching career, Dr. Bryan spent 33 years teaching here at Cumberland University as a biology professor. He was awarded the Cumberland University President's Award in Teaching Excellence in 2015. At this time, we'd like to welcome to the stage Coach Mitch Walters to introduce Dr. Bryan.
Heath, son, we're getting old. Thanks for bringing those up. Also, Lindsey Kitson, I've said you and Nick Payton's name should be on a lot of degrees that walked up this place while you were here, because Nick and Lindsey got him through. And I see Dr. Dishman back here, check your head, yes. Got him through college algebra. Dr. Dishman, nothing against algebra. But I haven't been an algebra problem since I walked out of that classroom at Penn State in 84. But I had to pass the damn class. Thanks, kids. I'd like to thank everyone in attendance this evening. A special thanks to Coach Pat. I'm Pabby. You're the most selfless man I've ever been around. You're a leader of people. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Katie Arnold, Kyle, Allen, and all their staff for all the hard work we put this on this evening, along with the cafeteria staff. And also, congratulations to this year's Hall of Fame inductees. 1998, we started the wrestling program. Dr. Bryan was named our first head coach. Danny had to start the program while teaching an overload back then all the coaches taught. Danny had to start the program while teaching an overload in the biology department. Had no assistant coaches. We started the program without facilities. Not a good practice. But Danny, you laid the foundation for one of our most successful programs. And you're a huge part of it. Some of our first wrestling student athletes also. Tyshawn Brown, Donnie Scruggs, the Grandstaff brothers, Jared and Matt, Eric McCray, John Young, Jason Brewer, Josh West, and our first All-American student wrestler. With no facility, oftentimes we have a basketball or volleyball game here. We'd be over at 10 o'clock at night. Here come the wrestlers, having to roll the mats in here. They would practice from 10 to midnight, sometimes 11 to 1 o'clock in the morning, with no facility. Oftentimes they'd have to practice out in the lobby of the gym, had to roll the mats in every night. But we were able to get a man on board by the name of Ron Gruber. Ron, back in the day, worked for Cracker Barrel here at 11. And Ron is in the College Wrestling Hall of Fame as a contributor. But Ron saw us start the program, and Ron endowed scholarships for wrestlers, which we still have to this day. He bought our first two sets of mats, so we have wrestling mats. He gave money for a wrestling room, you know, one of the best wrestling rooms, small college wrestling rooms in the country. And Ron has helped ever since. Greatly indebted to Mr. Magruder. Program is turning into one of our most successful. Coach Hicks here. James, are you here? Took a little bit too long to beat Frankie. But we finally figured out that riddle. Good job, son. But in the last 10 years, or excuse me, we've been ranked in the top 10 six times in the past 10 years. We're highest ranking at number 5 in the country in 2021. We've had 5 national champions. Keith Cup, rest in peace, Keith. Corey Bleeden, Corey with the Gordarian Award winner, which was the most outstanding wrestler at the national tournament. Corey is now a policeman in New York City. Jake Williams, 2-time national champion. And Cole Smith, Cole gets second on this year. We've had 34 All-Americans, 32 academic All-Americans, and 3 runners-up, Esco Williams, Scott Stewart, and Cody Linden. This success being built on the foundation that we've built, Dave. And all our past and current student athletes have continued, past and current student athletes have continued to build on that foundation. Congratulations on your induction. The wrestling injury got a bit of pitch in his hip bone.
It's good to see everyone tonight. Peter, I'm not even going to compete with your speech tonight. Zeke, you'd have 4.0 if you had taken my class. I also know about Little Man Syndrome. I have, still have, I'm just a little old man. It is an honor to be up here. And I have to say, it wasn't the effort of one man. This was a community effort to get the wrestling programs up here. It really was. It wasn't just me that started. It actually started with John and Spencer Pope. And I don't know if any of you know John and Spencer Pope, but they wrestled in Mount Julian High School, and his father, their father, taught history, my mom. And they kept nagging Monty about, we need a wrestling team here at Cumberland. And then David Wood, Kevin Atkins, and then Monty found out I had a wrestling background. And then here it came in on me. What was I going to do with it? So, you know, Monty Pope started this, well, his son started it, and then Monty took it and ran, and then my office was right across from Monty, so here he keeps throwing stuff in my door to get this program going. Geez, I have been in a wrestling for, at that time, years. What am I going to do? But I remember when I was an undergraduate at the University of Tennessee, and this wrestling team came to the University of Tennessee, which happened to be in a IA team just down the road called Carson. And Coach Don Leon was the coach at that time, and they came in here, who was Carson Newman? And at that time, it was NAIA team, and I found out real quick who Carson Newman was. Coach Leo was also the director of financial aid at Carson Newman. He was the first guy I taught. With Coach Aaliyah and Ron Magruder, John and Spencer
myself. And Ron McGreer was trying to sell this to President Martin at the time. We would benefit from having the rest of it. There was no doubt in my mind. And we finally got it through, got it approved. I had 2 months to recruit. You remember that, Pat? I had 2 months to recruit. Think that first year, thank God for intermatwrestling.com. I was able to get wrestlers from all over the country. 40, I think, is what I ended up with. All freshmen. I had this idea, I'm going to build this team from scratch. We're going to start with all freshmen. And by the fourth year, we're just going to be all wrong. Any of you ever been on a team with just freshmen? Absolutely no leadership. And I saw the light, this isn't going to work. So after the second year, I started going to junior colleges. Started recruiting junior colleges, getting in here. And one of the first junior college wrestlers I got was John Young at Virginia. And John was actually our first All-American. That was year three. Placed eighth at Nationals. As Mitch said, we made it to Nationals every year except for the first year. And we've been going ever since. That was awesome. But it took a community. Ron McGruder, if it wasn't for Ron, we would not have this program here today. And I was here many nights. Many nights, rolling the mats up, and I'd be here 8 o'clock in the morning to teach class. Always had an 8 o'clock class. My salary was just like teaching class. We're starting this program every year I was here. Dr. Stone, you probably don't even know this story. Many of you probably don't, but my last year of coaching, I started a PhD program. I'm still coaching, still recruiting, still teaching full-time, at a full-time level. Started classes at Tennessee Tech. Doing all this. I had to do my residency. I also taught class at Tennessee Tech for my residency and was doing my PhD research. Something had to give. I mean, that was going to kill me. That was absolutely going to kill me. But look where we are now. Coach Hicks, you're the man. Coach Hicks is going to be up here, I guarantee it. Zeke, you are awesome as well, as a student, as an athlete. And that's something I try to recruit, student athletes. That is one thing that I pride myself on, is the number of academic All-Americans that I have. Because I didn't just recruit the best residents, I recruited the best students. What's Coach Hicks doing? Same thing. I'm proud of him. He has taken it to the next level. Now, I've had a lot of questions asked about the balloons. The only table here that's got balloons, and my two daughters over there embarrassed me with them. My grandfather was a mule skinner. How many of you know what a mule skinner is? My grandfather had the biggest jack operation in Middle Tennessee. In other words, he bred and trained mules. As a matter of fact, the 1920s and 1930s, he drove a covered school wagon retired from Cumberland from wrestling, and I have now become a mule wrestler. There's supposed to be Jeb, one of my mules over there. There's supposed to be Jeb hanging up over there. It's in my blood, I guess, why I prefer mules over horses. We've got two mules. One is a sober soul. The other one has little man syndrome. He will never be forgiven. But that's okay. He's entertained. He is entertained. Pat, my mule. Well, a mule's a hybrid, right? Mule's a hybrid between a horse and a donkey. So I'm going to end this. If it's not half-ass, it's just a horse.
Ladies and gentlemen, our final induction of the evening. Every Hall of Fame would choose one team that had a special impact on the campus of Cumberland University. This year we'll be inducting the 2006-2007 Cumberland Women's Basketball Team. The team finished the year as the NAIA National Runner-Ups, making it to the National Championship game played in Jackson, Tennessee, the best finish of any Cumberland basketball team in history. You might have to play three consecutive nights in a row in win or go home situations. It is not easy. This team finished the season with a 27-8 record, entered the 27th AIA Women's National Championship as the number 5 seed. Cumberland picked up a first round win against number 4 seed Oklahoma Baptist, 72-58, moving on to the second round where they bested Lewis Clark State, 86-83. Cumberland then went through two number ones, beating Langston out of Oklahoma, 72-71, and Vanguard out of California, 68-64 in the Fab Four game. Cumberland lost the national championship game to in-state and trans-south rival Lambeth, 63-60, to finish as national runner-ups. Again, the best finish Cumberland women's basketball has ever had in the national tournament. Ashley Cross and Kiana Robinson were each named all-tournament first-team recipients, and Cross earned the Charles Stevenson Hustle Award. The team includes Cumberland Hall of Famer Renee Williams, Keisha Forrest, Ashley Cross, Juliana Fernandez, Tamika Hall, Hillary Bauer, Isabella Klinko, Lauren Duggar, C.K. Hughes, Eva Bukowski, Kiana Robinson, Carrie Maddox, Kristen Kirkland, Mariel Ruiz, and Kendall Angie. The team was coached by Clint Mason and Tony McLeod. At this time, we'd like to bring up the team's assistant coach, Tony McLeod, to talk about the team.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Tony McLeod. I was one of the coaches of this team, and I'm blessed and honored to be able to speak about these amazing women tonight. I want to start by expressing gratitude to a few people on behalf of the team. Apologies for forgetting anyone. First, a big thank you to our head coach, Coach Mason, who couldn't be here tonight. He's getting married this weekend. We wish him and his bride all the best, and thank him for all he did for this team. Coach Katrina, for all her hard work, to the managers and trainers for the dedication, the parents and family members of this team and coaching staff for their unwavering love and support. Pat Lawson, our super supportive athletic director. Coach Thompson and Coach Lewis for the men's staff. Tom Lynch, Rick Bell, Eric, Ronald Jackson for all their support. They were kind of our NIO before NIO. Coach Hunt and Coach Walters for always letting us use their facility. president at that time, Dr. Eaton from the school administration at 0607. Coach Pavitt, Dr. Arnold, Kyle Allen, Dr. Stone, the current athletic school administration, and the Hall of Fame committee for honoring this team. My family and students tonight, thank you for all your love and support. Now, everyone knows about these girls' accomplishments on the court, but they also have some records you may not have read about in the Tennessee and the London Democrat. For instance, they set the record for most late night visits to Taco Bell, thanks to late nights at Silverado's. Now, I'll never forget my phone ringing at about 2 a.m., more times than I can count, with Big Pete from Campus Safety calling to politely inform me I might need to come over to campus and help take care of a situation. Those records never made Tony Bryant's Arnold's. In all seriousness, we saw the potential for a likeness starting in the 05-06 season. I still remember this group beating Division I UT Martin. It's kind of funny that game mysteriously disappeared off their schedule. That year we went to Hawaii, made some great memories, and that season ended at the buzzer in the opening game of the national tournament. But it was the beginning of something special for this group. And shout out to our lone senior from that year, Cash Vance. Momentum carried into the 06-07 season. We beat a highly ranked Houston Baptist team by double digits. We also had regular season wins over nationally ranked Trans-South opponents, Union, Lambeth, Martin Methodist, and Freed Harbor. Our conference, the Trans-South, is the toughest in the country. We were a better seed at the national tournament than we were in our own conference tournament that year. In the tournament first game, CK came out hot early. We came out strong and beat Oklahoma Baptist. The second round, as you mentioned, saw us take down Lewis and Clark State, who were 31-2 at the time. Keisha came in and had some big baskets in that game. In the quarterfinals, we got a one-point victory over Langston. I remember Renee Nash made some big free throws down the stretch. Last play of the game, they had the ball sideline down for 6 seconds to go. We came out and managed to get the ball and was in 2-3 zone and got the stop. I know a lot of times the team remembers the last game. The final four was that game for this team. We played the number one team in the nation, the number one overall seed in the tournament, Vanguard. They were 31-0 coming into that game, and they were the clear favorites. Nobody gave us much of a chance. We were hot from three early, but defensively we forced 20 turnovers. They had a point guard that everybody said was kind of the engine that made them go. That engine never saw 94 feet of defense from Ashley Cross before. There are three plays that stand out from that game. One of them ended up being a newspaper headline that said, Robinson brings the Bronx to Jackson, Tennessee. When Kiki made a move at the foul line, that left the National Player of the Year stuck in her tracks as she laid the ball in the basket. The other was a play we ran with about a minute left. We were down one, had the ball on a baseline out of bounds. I still remember the play that we drew up. I remember asking Coach Mason if I could draw something up, and him having the confidence in me to say yes. I remember my knees shaking, praying that it would work. Izzy came off the screen, hit the three, gave us the lead. And then the final one was about 12 seconds left. We had the ball, late in the shot clock, and Renee stepped up, hit the big three to put the game away as the shot clock buzzer went off. This game produced one of my favorite pictures in the paper, where Renee has her hands up, and Carrie has her hand in the air, giving her a high five with the biggest smile on her face. I don't know if Carrie was smiling because we won, or because the only game on here she didn't foul out. Now, a lot of people, I look back on a season like this and think, what if? What if one of our top scorers hadn't got hurt? What if we had shot better in the finals? But I prefer to look back at this season and say thank you. Thank you to this group of women for giving Cumberland, this town, and everyone here a memory that's going to last a lifetime. This group was special. We truly had talent from all over the world. The post who always kept us laughing and worked hard, the multi-sport Kendall Agee from Sparta, Tennessee. The guard who always made us laugh and gave it her all, Hill Bill, Hillary Bowen from Huntland, Tennessee. The outside shooter and hilarious, Eva Bukowska from Gdansk, Poland. The point guard who was slow but tough and mighty and won the Hustle Award, Ashley Cross from Clarksville, Tennessee. The guard with one of the purest shooting strokes you'll ever see, Isabelle Cunico from Paraná, Brazil. The post, also with a sweet outside stroke, who could absolutely score, Lauren Dunder from Brentwood, Tennessee. The guard with leadership skills and some sweet passes, Juliana Fernandez from Florianopolis, Brazil. The freshman who always wanted to learn and get better, and who I think of every time I hear a certain song, she knows what it is, Keisha Forrest from Bowling Green, Kentucky. The post with the putbacks and the stare down, who almost killed Coach Mason from there for practice, Tamika Hall from Kingston, Jamaica. The all-conference and dominant, versatile wing player, the smoothest who was a bucket anywhere on the floor, Sakayla Hughes from Columbia, Tennessee. The local girl, the always standing and always ready, Christy Kirkland from Lebanon, Tennessee. The girl who sacrificed her body every single minute, whether it was a practice or a game for her team. I can see her in the coaching ranks now, Carrie Maddox from Hendersonville, Tennessee. The one with all the moves and the clutch baskets, Kiana Robinson from the Bronx, New York. The post with the ability to step up and knock down the three block shots, Maria Ruiz from the Miami, Brazil. And the All-American and Cumberland Hall of Famer, the one inside and outside threat who I probably spent the most time in the gym rebounding for, Renee Williams from Oak Ridge, Tennessee. At this time, I invite you special ladies to please come up and join me on stage. Ladies and gentlemen, the 2006-2007 Hall of Fame, Cumberland University.
Ladies and gentlemen, we'll be closing here in just a moment. We'll have Ron Madden back on the stage. While he's taking a picture, I will give you a quick story about Ron. I call the Cumberland basketball games here, and a few years ago, I had a fender bender getting off the exit in some traffic. Probably still the only guy you've ever met to total a car going 15 miles an hour, but it happened. So I forced him to sign the interstate with traffic's in capacity, called Sports Information Director Kyle Allen, and say, "Dude, I'm not going to make it. I don't think I'm going to make it." And he said, "All right, I'll try my best." I told him, "I might make it or might not. I don't know. I don't know how these things go." Well, it was a good Lord in heaven. I did make it. Made it by about halftime of the girls' game. And there sits Ron Patton doing the color commentary along with God. 5 years later, he's still sitting there. Come on, Ron.
First of all, give it up for John Boyce. Mark, where are you? Good to see you down, Mark. Mark, thank you for coming. One thing that you know that you have to recognize, we have some unique, hardworking, we have three people in the athletic department, myself, Katie Arnold, and Kyle. We have some GAs. We have 31 sports, 700 athletes. We have a sport almost every day. So I would like our GAs to stand up. We're over here. Thank you. Thank you for attending. May God bless you. Go Phoenix. The inductees, we need you to take a picture of them on the side over here and then in the back. The inductees, we need pictures up front and then in the back. Inductees, we need a picture up front and then in the back. Thank you.